This is a talk which is, should not come from a clinician. It should have come from managers. And I would have liked managers sitting here listening to it rather than the real players, you know, who are surgeons and anesthetists. Anyway, so since it's always a pleasure to have these topics, such vague topics, and, you know, dwell on them, learn more about it. So it was a good opportunity for me to go into these details. Thank you very much. Coming to the robotics, now, Intuitive Surgical hit the market in 1999 with Da Vinci, and the company and its early adopters hailed the new technology as the revolution that would benefit patients, surgeons, and healthcare system as a whole. Can it be called an innovation? No, there is a part. I went into the definition of what is innovation. The process of translating an idea or invention into a good or service that creates value for which customers will pay is what is innovation. There is another part which is hidden, which is here. To be called an innovation, the idea must be replicable at an economical cost and must satisfy a specific need. So with that definition, can you call robotics or Da Vinci an innovation? You know, it's anybody's guess. There are innovations which have been hailed in medical community. They can be high tech, they can be low tech, they can be just an idea, and they are innovations. Now, MRI scanners, cardiac stents, checklists like hand washing and cleaning the skin reduces their IV line infections to zero. That's an innovation. Diabetic smartphone applications which transmit the real-time glucose to the diabetologist could be an innovation. Wireless home monitoring systems, high-tech caps for drug bottles, which tell defaulters that they have not taken their today's dose. These are all innovations which will change the way we will look at things. And that's why Da Vinci, when it was in 2012 in New York Times editorial written by Emmanuel, who is a professor at Wharton in health management, wrote that it's a pseudo-innovation that increases the cost with healthcare benefits. Well, it's his opinion. Let's go along with that. Should I start a robotic program? First of all, do you believe in technology? Unless you believe in it, one should not even think of it. And there has to be a risk-benefit analysis. Will it benefit the patients? Will it benefit the hospital? So everything has to be taken into consideration. Both surgeon and patients may be enthusiastic for a new technology, despite the lack of demonstrable improved outcomes. Unfortunately, till date, we don't have level A evidence for robotic surgery. We have just have retrospective comparisons, because those who are practicing robotics are just doing robotics. They will give their experiences. There is no hand-to-hand comparison till late. Now, some has started coming up now, and it's one of the papers which has recently came where there was no doubt that robotic-assisted laparoscopic prostatectomy was superior to open surgery as far as the cost, as far as the blood loss and rest of the things. But there was always a debate, is it better than laparoscopy? If those people can give you equal results with their results were never demonstrated superior to laparoscopic prostatectomy. And this was one of the analysis from NHS system, which said that over 10 years, robotic prostatectomy was more costly than laparoscopic prostatectomy, but more effective with gains of quality of life years of 0.8, you know, very minimal difference. And it was cost effective only at a threshold of £330,000 quality of life years, per quality of life years. So that's what they have come out with. Higher cost of robotic prostatectomy may be offset by modest health gains if more than 150 cases are performed each year. So such comparative effective research has to come forth. There more and more has to be forthcoming. And if such analysis is available, hospitals could use this information in response to pressure from tech profile surgeons like us, who would pressurize them to buy robots. Surgeons could use it in discussing treatment options with the patients, and patients could use it to make a treatment choices. And payers could use it for negotiating reimbursement. So unfortunately, we don't have those data yet. That's the problem. So should I start a robotic program? What does it give to the hospital? It gives to the hospital a promise of new patients. Patients who are coming for robotic surgery And indirectly, you know, like in the era of lithotripsy, you didn't want patients coming for lithotripsy. You knew that if the patients come for lithotripsy, there would be patients coming for percutaneous surgery, there would be patients coming for ureteroscopy, and so forth. So identifying institution as technically advanced, patients would be coming, this is a good hospital. Let's go to this hospital. This attracts and retains surgeons, best surgeons. It attracts top trainees. In as early as 2010, in US, there was a survey when the surgical aspirants were asked, what do you think, do you want robotic as part of your curriculum? You would be surprised, even in 2000, 50% of them responded yes, they would like robotics to be part of curriculum, while only 20% of the hospitals had the capability to provide it. So you would have the best of those residents coming to you if you have such tech, high-tech equipments with you. And you have a potential of becoming a training site. So these are the various things that the hospital may look at. For a patient, it reduces analgesic requirement, it reduces recovery time, and it reduces the blood loss. For a surgeon, it reduces the learning curve. It is ergonomic, helping aging surgeon with degenerative disc disease. I had a cervical disc problem 6 months ago. And for 2 months, I could do only robotic surgery. I could not do any endoscopic or open surgery. So for me, it was a boon at that time. Reduces risk of blood-borne diseases. You know, you have those hep C transmissions, HIV transmissions. Being away from being a transplant surgeon, we are always exposed to it. We have had transplant surgeons who have died with hepatitis C disease. So it'll keep me away from those blood-borne infections. So while establishing a robotic program, due diligence has to be done before buying. Do I have the infrastructure, and do I have the champions? So that's the basic thing. One should have all the theaters these days in all major hospitals, if you see, they are overpacked. People are operating at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, waiting for their turns. Where is the space? Unless you have an infrastructure you can't think of, you have to dedicate a theater to robotics. Do I have the champion? If you see, all successful robotic programs will have at least one or two champions who would say that, well, I am committed, I am ready to do it. You bring in, I'll dedicate myself. If you don't have those champions, it's impossible to have a successful program. It is interesting that robot may be bought for desperate reasons, despite being financially viable. No, it's all right. If you know why you are buying it, if you are not buying it for financial gains, then don't complain tomorrow. Don't say that it's not financially viable. And they may buy it for competition to attract surgeons and patients. They may buy it to as a surgeon's preference, or it compelled to keep up with the market demands or make the place a high tech, as I said earlier. So initial planning and budgeting, choice of a robot, unfortunately, as of date, we don't have any. So time would come when you would have a choice and when you would discuss which robot to buy. Sparing of OR facilities, as I said, that unless you have an infrastructure, you need to have an OR facility. Utilization and manpower, most ORs are already overburdened. And there has to be a timeline if you want to have a robot at your place. There is a financing should be finalized within 6 to 12 months, OR modifications within 3 months, and then hiring of personnel within 1 to 6 months, and staff training within 1 to 3 months, which is important. If by the time the equipment comes, your robot OR is not ready, your personnel are not trained, you would have a lag time. You would be losing money every day. So in finances, what are the initial fixed costs? Initial cost is high. And everybody knows that initial cost recovery is difficult. Robotics provides the lowest profit margins as compared to open and lab. If you do the same procedure by open or lab, you have a much higher margin. Hospital has a much higher margin. You will be working on a very, very slim profits if you are doing it robotically. And payers do not provide premium for robotics. Most of the places, even at our place, you know, the insurance would refuse to pay. CGHS doesn't pay for robotics separately. Now there are certain categories. So the payers are not providing. So then what is the option? Look for an option for a benefactor. No, everybody doesn't have a vatikuti, but if you have some vatikutis at your places, get hold of one. Or you can lease the equipment. That could be other alternatives. Personnel, training cost for physician and nurses and technicians, these are, you train them directly and you miss them during the period they have been sent on training. So that's, it's a dual expenditure that you are making. So there are direct and indirect cost of personnel training. Maintenance contract, which means that if you have an initial high cost and you have to give every year a maintenance contract, the only way you can reduce this to less per patient is bringing in more patients. So, which means that multiple users, multiple specialties. That's the mantra. If you have multiple users at a place, and if you have a multiple surgeons within a specialty, you are likely to be more successful than one. But yes, again, I would say there has to be a champion who would lead the way and show others that how it can be done and how it is possible. The numbers are crucial. Now, if you look at the cost, the fixed cost, acquisition cost is one huge chunk in India is approximately, say, 12 crores. If you amortize to 6 years, which they say is the life of a robot, it's a 2 crores a year. The AMC is approximately 70 lakhs. So 2 crores, 70 lakhs is the cost that you have to spend every year on the robot. If you look at the cost per patient, now here's the number cruncher, that if you have 100 patients, do 100 patients a year, the per cost patient cost is 2.7 lakhs. And if you have 400, it's down to 70,000. So more the numbers, the per patient cost keeps on coming down. Finances, cost per patient. Disposable drapes, these are per patient. So, you know, irrespective of the numbers you do, you would be spending this much with every patient. Disposable instruments and consumables, approximately 0.75,000 per case. Depends on the instrument use. I was impressed yesterday when I saw some of the visitors from outside who are regular robotic users showing how it can be done. You saw Alex showing he doesn't use a bipolar. He just uses a prograsp and a monopolar. Guru, he was showing all his lymph node dissection with just using the hook, which cost half the cost of a hot shear. So if you can do it with hook, why use the hot shears? Single needle holder, again, Alex showed, he was doing a conduit, and while doing a conduit, he was using a needle holder and a prograsp in other hand. You know, you can do away with one needle holder. Fourth arm or a second assistant. In Henry Ford, I have never seen a fourth arm being used. They always have, since they have a lot of assistants, a fourth assistant would be sitting there and using an instrument. So to hold everything. So these are the ways, you know, you can innovate, you can use to, and as time goes by, one knows that how to use less and less instruments in each case. So what are the financial gains? Reduces the post-operative hospital costs like ICU stays, blood transfusions, early discharges. And these result not only in the hospital gains, these are productivity gains for the company who sends the patient, his patient to you. If the patient can join back in 2 weeks to his work instead of 6 weeks, they have those 4 weeks for your productivity gains. More available beds, resulting in more admissions. There is a very interesting analysis here. If you see here, these are the two examples where they have shown that 126 patients being operated and 330 patients operated. If you see the spare number of hospital, because of the hospital stay, the beds being available for extra, and these beds being used for other surgeries. If you see that, you know, maybe you can't see it very well, but years to pay off acquisition is, while it's 36 years if you have less patients, it's half a year, within 4 months, if it is more than 360 patients. There is a return on investment 2.7% if it is 126 patients, and it is 381% if it is 330 patients per year. So marketing department has its share to do. Dealing with third-party payers, you know, the insurance won't pay for this. You have to deal with them. They have to make them agree to pay for robotics. Shifting balance cost to the patient, like we have done for CGHS or Army patients. They let their organization pay whatever they are paying. The rest of the balance is being paid by the patients. That's another way to deal with it. Bringing in surgical volumes, again, analyzing primary market and exploring secondary and tertiary market. You know, secondary market, you can't rely on patients coming from your pool. You have to look at other states. You have to look at, if you have a champion in robotic prostatectomy, what is the harm in going to Africa and seeing a market there and bringing in patients there? You would have the disease is prevalent there. Look at areas where the disease is prevalent and go there. So that's the another marketing. Initially, that's Da Vinci marketing, which has been criticized for it. I recommend Da Vinci surgery because there was no objective data. So they use the patient side data. I feel less pain, so let's do robotic surgery. I recovered quickly, so let's do robotic surgery. Look at what Mark Pauly said, that this can be criticized, but you know, he's another professor at Wharton in health management system. The critics say that the long run, there is no difference in the outcomes. The main difference is in short run, where there is a shorter length of stay and fewer complications, a less unpleasant experience for the patient involved. I don't think you ought to regard that as being of no value. If I'm a patient, I don't care about the cost. I just want to have the best thing done for myself. And anything that makes the process shorter, which robotic surgery does, is something of value. And here is a paper in New England Journal of Medicine, which showed that even in patients more than 65 years, the choice of robotic surgery, choice of prostatectomy, increased by 14% within 3 years from 2005 to 2007. So investing over robotic OR, that's another important. Room size should be adequate, layout, dual projection and silver-coated screen, dedicated room rather than a moving robot, and dedicated staff. If you bring down operating time, you bring in the operative cost. So it's a Henry Ford Hospital where there are two large screens, which are 3D, which it makes life so much better for the assistant. He sees in 3D, he's able to help you better. It cuts down the operative time. Requirements, reduce operating time and faster turnover. CO2 supply should be warm, high flow. It should be dual source. If one goes away, there should always be the second one which is available. The lens warming system should be available. Suction and irrigator system, so that you spend as little time as possible. Enough instruments to perform two back-to-back procedures, so that you have less changeover time. In our place, we often anesthetize the patient in second theater if we have three patients. Even sometimes, some part of initial dissection is done laparoscopically before the patient is moved in, so we can push in three patients in a day or do more procedures in a day. Use single lens as far as possible. You know, with experience, most of the people use just 0-degree lens for most of the procedures. You know, 30 down lens for robot, single lens 30 down for kidney, single 0-degree for prostate. Dedicated team, reward for the third case. If you are able to push third case, you have to recognize your team, which have been able to do it. Video monitoring of what, not during the when you are doing the case, you are there, but during inactivity, see how much is the turnover time, what's happening. If you reduce the turnover time, you would be able to push that extra case and you would be able to do more. So it's a teamwork. Changing assistants, nurses, and anesthetists result in delays, longer OR times, and even morbidity. Highly skilled assistant is needed. We all know that. Second assistant or fourth arm, I have already said about it. Hold hands, elevate them, reward all of them. And subspecialist for a specialist area will bring down the operating time and you would be able to do more. So there is a research angle. Robotic is a technology looking for new usage. Look for one, and if you can do that, if it satisfies you, it brings recognition for the hospital. If your center is recognized, your volumes are going to increase, like we have done for robotic transplants. Monitoring outcomes and success, that's another thing. You know, not only the surgical variables, look at the OR efficiency, look at customer satisfaction, and docking time, changeover time, number of cases being done every month, every year, and that's how you would be able to have a successful team. So comparative effectiveness isn't always black and white. It takes many years of experience with a new methodology to really determine how well it's working. If something doesn't appear to improve the quality of life today, it could do tomorrow. If it's not able to show it for a whole lot of patients, it could show for a smaller group of patients. And we have to wait for that time. Does cost of cancer treatment justify its use? Cancer treatment that might cost $100,000 per course and only increases the life by a couple of months, is it justified to say that that's a justification? Or lasers, we have been seeing for the last 20 years. There is still an evolution. We are still using them. It's another health management guy from Wharton. He says that, say, we decide that the incremental improvement is not worth the cost, and we are going to put a kibosh on it. So we go back to open surgery? Do you want to do that? If we do that, we are going to harm innovation. Maybe the version we have today of robotic surgery isn't producing good enough results, but the robotic surgery of next decade will be built on the mistakes and the knowledge that was generated in this era. And that could bring in the major improvement. Thank you very much.
Thank you.